You're driving down the road on your way to work. But then, oh no, traffic jam, again. The minutes slowly pass by as you're stewing in your car, waiting for the column to budge. Finally, it does. Barely. But there's good news. The city will widen the road to 6 lanes in order to solve the traffic problem. And once they do, as promised, traffic starts to flow. But then, a few months later, oh no, traffic jam again? The road is widened again, this time to 8 lanes. Again, traffic starts to flow, but a few months later, you guessed it, traffic jam. Where did all these cars come from? How come the roads always fill up, no matter how much we widen them? This phenomenon is called induced demand. It was first discovered in America in 1930. Back then it was called traffic generation. And since then, politicians around the world have been doing their best to pretend it doesn't exist. Induced demand, in the simplest terms, means that adding more lanes, thus making traffic flow faster, will motivate more people to get in their cars, leading to more traffic. This is why, when we widen the road, more cars appear on it, seemingly out of nowhere. Those extra cars are driven by those people who would have otherwise chosen alternative modes of transit to get around. Some would have taken the train, some the bus, some the bike, others would have walked, as driving was slow due to traffic jams. But as soon as the road was widened and the traffic jams disappeared, thousands of people happily switched back to their fast and comfortable cars for their commute, thereby causing traffic jams once again. Fair enough, you might say, but if the demand is there, we could just keep widening the road until everyone fits, thereby solving the traffic jam problem. Right? Unfortunately, no. In Texas, the KT freeway was widened to its current, unbelievable 26 lanes in width to ease traffic. Once the project was completed, however, commute times in the morning increased by 30% and in the evening by 55%. In other words, the state of Texas spent $2.8 billion to make their commute worse. All because politicians chose to pretend yet again that induced demand isn't real. Building more lanes will not solve traffic. Not in 1930, not now, not ever. As urban planner Lewis Mumford said in 1955, building more roads to prevent congestion is like a fat man loosening his belt to prevent obesity. Self-driving cars won't get us out of this mess either. If anything, they would only make things much worse. Imagine someone owning 3 cars with a self-driving function. They get in the first and go shopping. Then they send the second one to pick up their kid from school, and the third to go to the mechanic. One person just generated 3 cars worth of traffic. So unless you can find a way to widen the KT freeway from 26 lanes to 78, self-driving cars are a bad idea. So what's the actual solution to traffic? Counterintuitively, it's the reduction of road capacity, coupled with providing good alternatives. The more good alternatives you provide, while simultaneously scaling down expensive car infrastructure, the more people will leave their cars at home, thereby reducing traffic jams. Let's take this average 6-lane road. Dedicating 2 lanes to public transit and turning 2 other lanes into safe, separated bike paths will actually increase road capacity and also reduce traffic as people opt for the faster tram, bus or bike instead of the slow, jammed car lanes. Because, turns out, induced demand also works in reverse. The more you widen the road, the more people will choose the car and the more traffic jams you get. The more you narrow the road, the less people will choose the car and the less traffic jams you get. As the saying goes, if you plan your cities for cars and traffic, you get cars and traffic. If you plan for people and places, you get people and places. Of course, this requires political courage. Initially, any such measure will meet stiff opposition from people used to the convenience and comfort of their cars. The same thing happened in Amsterdam, if you can believe it. Back then, the population was largely hostile towards anti-congestion, bike-friendly measures. But now that people saw what decongestion and car-free living mean, everyone got on board and started demanding even more. As you can see, the problem of traffic jams isn't unsolvable. Amsterdam has already done it, and there is nothing stopping your city from becoming the next Amsterdam. In fact, chances are your city already is Amsterdam in the 1960s. All it takes to fix traffic is political courage, something increasingly rare these days. So don't be afraid of decongestion and lane reduction measures. They will not make traffic worse. On the contrary, those are the only solutions ever known to finally, once and for all, fix traffic.